Namaskar. On behalf of the Raza Foundation and India Habitat Center, we welcome you to this fifth Kumar Gandhar Memorial Lecture. The foundation organizes every year 8 memorial lectures. They are to commemorate the vision, the attainments, and the continuing presence of 8 great masters from the field of music, theatre, Habib Tanveer, dance, Keluchan Mahapatri, literature, Agge, philosophy, Daya Krishna, architecture, Charles Correa, cinema, Manikor. And we have had 4 memorial lectures in the Kumar Gandhar series, delivered by Mukundalal, T.M. Krishna, Vijay Kichlu, and Deepak S. Raja. Before we start the lecture, we have a short film which the eminent photographer, particularly eminent for having photographed classical musicians and classical dancers for nearly 50 years, Mr. Avinash Pasricha, who is here. And this, I don't know whether you call it a film or not, but whatever it is, was done especially when Kumar Gandhar turned 60 years. There was a huge, big festival in Siri Fort, and even I had come from Bhopal to attend it. So this is that film. So you'll see it first, and then I'll introduce Dr. Sumangala Damodaran. But before that, see the film.
Prodigy, Shivaputra Sidramaya Kumkari took the music world by storm and was hailed by connoisseurs as Kumar Gandhar. Today, Kumar Gandhar is 60. Chamundi. Kumarji's friends, students and admirers all flock to this core of graceful harmony. Here, in the midst of his family, his wife Vasundharaji, daughter Kalapini, son Mukul and grandson Bhuvan, Kumarji continues his quest into music and literature, absorbing the minutest details of the life around him. These find unified creative expression in his compositions. Shri Siddaramaiah and his wife, Kumarji found a teacher in the renowned musicologist Professor B. R. Devdhar, himself a leading disciple of Pandit Vishnu Digambar Paluskar. At Devdhar's School of Indian Music, young Kumar, as an enthusiastic organizer of musical soirees, came across many a stalwart, as well as the then budding talents, among them Pandit V.G. Jog, Begum Akhtar, Pandit Ravi Shankar and Ustad Ali Akbar Khan. Kumarji at Uday Shankar's Almora Center was perhaps the youngest celebrity in the galaxy of renowned musicians. During these years, Kumarji found a companion in Bhanumati Kaunts, whom he subsequently married. Their son, Mukul, in the footsteps of his father, not unexpectedly, began singing at an early age. Caused him to be confined to bed. His illness brought him to Devas, and during the bedridden years, Kumarji achieved a rare and deep insight into the folk music of Malwa. Kumarji's first concert, after 5 long years of silence, was attended by none other than Pandit Jawaharlal. After the unfortunate demise of young Bhanumati, Kumarji married Vasundhara Shrikhande, an able disciple who has since partnered him in life as in his music. Kumarji's creative genius manifested itself in the many compositions that he created in already existing rags and composite programs. Recognition came from all quarters in the form of awards. Having scaled the pinnacle, his music has continued to grow and evolve.
Memorial lecture that I forgot was B.S. Gaitonde, the great painter. Sumangala Damodaran, I heard her for the first time in a seminar in Nehru Library, which no longer holds such seminars. But at that time, it was still an interesting dynamic forum on IPTA, and I heard her speak on IPTA's music. And then I thought here was a new person we should watch with some interest. So here you are, caught in my net, finally. And we are very grateful that you agreed to give us this memorial lecture called History, Memory and Emotion in Understanding Music as Politics. This could be as complicated as possible, but there you are. Music is not a simple matter. It's a very complex matter, as most of you perhaps here know. Now, Sumangala is a professor of economics, development studies and popular music studies at Ambedkar University. At that time, you were in JNU, I thought, no? Maybe no, so. You're always in Ambedkar. And she was involved in research and documentation of a forgotten musical tradition, that of the Indian People's Theatre Association from the 1940s to the 50s, and had also performed from the documented repertoire extensively in different parts of the country and abroad. This work has resulted in a book, The Radical Impulse, Music in the Tradition of the IPTA, and an album titled Songs of Protest. She's also collaborated poets and musicians from South Africa around a project titled Insurrections, which has resulted in 3 albums. Why don't you also collaborate with protesting poets in India? They're not quite a large number here. We all think we are protesting. She is currently engaged in researching the relationship between music and migration, particularly of women in slavery and servitude across centuries and across vast tracts of the globe that were linked through long distance trade in commodities and symbolic goods. So there you are, Dr. Sumangala Damodar.
I'm deeply honored to be giving the Kumar Gandhar Memorial Lecture this year, and I really do not know whether I deserve this or not. So I thank Ashok Vajpayee ji profusely for this honor, and the Raza Foundation also for this opportunity. Like many others, I've been an ardent listener of Kumar ji's music, and also had the good fortune of listening to him sing live a few months before he passed away. His unusual and enigmatic style of composition and singing has been analyzed from various perspectives. And as I said, I don't think I really have the right to be, you know, analyzing Kumarji's music. There are people here who knew him and who understood his work, you know, for a large part of his life. But I thought I'd just start with a couple of things that have been said about him and then go on to what I have to say. His music, it has been argued, sought to spurn the very concept of the gharana, even while having been trained within the tradition. This is what one of the things that was said about him. Others firmly believe that he was the true classicist, rescuing classical music to its original ethos from the straitjacket of the gharana. As a teacher, he would show his pupils the kirana approach to a note, which is a bit like a single point stroke, and also the agra approach, which is more a broad brush technique, and then leave it to them to decide how they wanted to interpret it, writes Nikhil Inamdar. Shiva Mudgal writes, Kumar Gandhar crafted a voice that howled like the wind, carried shades of joy, lament, love and loss, modeling it on the sounds of the folk music that he had introspected on for years. Not so much a result of endless hours of riyaz, but is in fact a much deeper philosophical observation of, like nature, the vagaries of the human mind and heart, and the study of silence, symmetry and asymmetry. Given the great legacy and the large corpus of music that he left behind, animating debates that center around questions of tradition, the classical and the folk, and about the nuances of expression, I hope what I have to say will honor his memory. Aj akha varish shanu, kito kabra vichu bol. Please forgive my Punjabi pronunciation. Te aj kitave ishkda, koi agla varka phol. Today I call you, Varisha, speak from inside your grave. And today, turn the book of love's next page. Ik roi si thi Punjab di, tu likh likh mare vain, aj lakha tiya rodiya, tenu Varisha nu ken. Once one daughter of Punjab cried, and you wrote a saga of sadness. Today, a million daughters cry out to you, Varisha. Amrita Pritam wrote this here as a response to the violence, particularly against women, during the partition of India. She addressed it to the 18th century Punjabi poet, Varisha, who had written the popular version of the love story, Heer Rancha. The poem, which is sung in the form of the classic Heer, which is said to owe its origins to Varisha, appeals to him to rise from his grave, record Punjab's tragedy, and turn over a new page in Punjab's history. A few years before, a young woman, Swatantrata, stood in front of a microphone facing a mass gathering of more than 80,000 peasants in Lahore. She sang a heer which related the story of a young girl from faraway Bengal who lost her home and family
to the ravages of a terrible famine, which was the Bengal famine. Kinu phol dasa dukh dard sayo, tera rog tala ilaj dise, kar kaat sai karnu chutte mento, kyu sawal hai bina jawab dise. To whom can I tell my sad story? Who can cure me of my malady? I have lost my home and family. Who can answer my innumerable questions? When the lyrics of the Heer, written by Sheila Bhatia, a prominent songwriter of the left cultural movement in Lahore at that time, and it was sung by young Swatantrata, who was a singer and also a budding artist. These are examples of how a traditional ballad formed from Punjab was used to respond to significant political events at the cusp of independence in India. The musical rendition of the Heer in its classical or canonical form, as I said, is said to have come from Barish Shah in the 18th century and is sung in variants of the Bhairavi or Ahir Bhairav Raga. Both these versions of the Heer did not recount a local story or the centuries-old love story of Heer Ranjha. They were using a local indigenous form to respond in the first case to the horrors of partition and in the second case to ask for solidarity from peasants in the Punjab towards peasants in Bengal and their cooperation for the transfer of grain to Bengal. The Heer, the evocative lament for things lost, appealed for comradeship based on new solidarities between peasantries, between people across long distances who shared their opposition to colonialism. Let us go far away from India to pay attention to what the Spanish poet and playwright Federico Garcia Lorca had to say about a certain kind of song, the cante hondo, or the deep song, sung in Spain historically, and whose variants are found in certain kinds of flamenco singing. I quote, "The essential difference between cante hondo and flamenco is that the origin of the former must be sought in the primitive musical systems of India, that is, in the first manifestations of song, while the latter, a consequence of the first, cannot be said to acquire its definitive form until the 18th century. The former, that is the deep song, is song imbued with the mysterious color of primordial ages." He was writing in the 1920s. "The latter is relatively modern, its emotional interest eclipsed by that of the other. That is to say that cante hondo, like the primitive musical systems of India, is merely a stammer, an emission, higher or lower in pitch of the voice, a marvelous buccal undulation that breaks out of the echoing prison of our tempered scale, will not suffer the cold, rigid pentagram of our modern music, and makes the hermetic flowers of semitones open in a thousand petals." The Heer and the cante hondo are two examples of musical forms that bear a striking resemblance to each other and are found over long geographical distances, starting, we don't know whether it starts from here, but they are found in our part of the world and neighboring regions, traveling through West Asia, Greece, Turkey and Cyprus in the Mediterranean, various parts of North Africa, Mali, Ethiopia and southern Spain. A traveler could travel along this musical route, starting from, say, our part of the world, or start the other way around, from Africa, to travel to the east, covering vast landscapes all the way to the Punjab. This music is very often about migration, separation, refugeedom, persecution, and intense nostalgia, and expresses itself in varied ways through combinations which in the Indian tradition are classified under the Bhairavi or Bhairav family of scales. It would be closest to the natural minor scale in Western classical music, the Phrygian scale in ancient Greek music, and corresponding to the Hijaz maqam in Turkish, Persian or Egyptian classical music systems. Further, across these vast distances, it also underpins contemporary musical expression around these themes, indicating a historical trajectory across space and time that left deep imprints through emotion and the power of the forms that might have traveled. So, from the here in the Indian subcontinent to the Amanis or Rembetika in Greece, Cyprus or Turkey, to the Nuba Menhun or Nubasha in Egypt, Tunisia or Morocco, to the Solearis Segurias or Bulerias flamenco songs in southern Spain, the same echoes are heard with some persistence. Is this connection because of connected histories? Is it that human beings have some universal modes of singing about loss? What is the relationship between music and emotion? These are complex questions with no easy and certainly not one answer. With regard to the first question about connected histories, there is abundant evidence that there were fascinating connections between these far-flung places through maritime and overland trade and migration of people, and along with them, cultural forms. These connections, which were consolidated along the Indian Ocean Rim or the Silk Road between the 7th and 15th centuries, that is, before European colonial expansion, were reflected in musical forms, and the example that I have spoken of is one that reflects the influences. This period also saw philosophies and theories of music performance practice being written in Cordoba, Persia, Baghdad, India and China, reflecting in fact the influences. The connections are not adequately acknowledged in historical or musicological work, and this work is only beginning to be done. I have highlighted the case of this family of melodies, which are generally, with variation, minor note based, or where Komal swars are used, because they present an interesting case of how music, even if it is not consciously doing politics, can become politics. In the case of Amrita Pritam's Heer after the partition, or Sheila Bhatia's Heer during the Bengal famine, they were both responding to concrete political situations, both of which were shattering, not least because of the quantum of loss of lives and acute trauma. Both of them responded with a form that has historically been employed to sing about loss and separation. But this kind of melody or family of melodies has also become political by its very existence. Somewhere in the middle of the 20th century, a debate in Greece about its Hellenistic or European positioning, pitted against its Asiatic or Eastern or Oriental belonging, centered around these very melodies. It was stated, for example, by a prominent psychiatrist in the 1950s that Greeks could be made to be less depressive and more rational by turning them away from a lot of their music, which sounded sad and had Oriental roots, and that they should be encouraged to listen more to European music. The music, by its very existence and in fact persistence across centuries, had become an expression of politics even without consciously being so. Lorca, when he talks about the tempered scale and of the expressiveness of semitones, is referring to this politics and a history of superiority of the Western classical music system over the so-called primitive musics of the non-West. My own work has been about music and politics. I have arrived at some observations about music in politics and music as politics, if such a distinction can be made, on the basis of studying the repertoire of an important cultural political organization in the Indian context, the Indian People's Theatre Association. The IPTA, as we know, came into existence as a formal organization in 1943, and this was perhaps one of the first attempts to consciously use culture to articulate protest. I embarked upon the study of the Ipta tradition, when I use the term Ipta tradition, what I mean is not just the Ipta as an organization, but several other organizations, regional variants, which were found in different parts of the country, which then also aligned themselves with the ideas of the Ipta. I embarked upon the study of the tradition for specific reasons, stemming from my own experience as a cultural activist. Having sung for a couple of decades songs that came formally under the category of protest or political music. The first reason arose because of stereotypes that exist, certainly in more recent decades in India, about protest music having a typically standardized structure. For example, sounding agitational and mobilizational, conveying political messages stridently through lyrics, tunes, and tempo, mostly being sung by a collective, and so on. And perhaps for these reasons, not being good enough as music. This stereotype has resulted, on the one hand, in activist musicians as well as political formations not considering songs as protest songs or even political music unless they conform to the standardized stereotype with respect to form and content, and non-activist musicians dismissing protest music as mere sloganeering, on the other. This argument extends to music that is considered political, where the seriousness of it as music is often considered of secondary importance. I have argued, on the basis of the Ipta tradition's varied music, that it is possible to understand protest music and more generally political music as a highly varied and historically evolved kind of music, and for its legitimacy as music meriting analysis on its own terms. When we do this, that is, understand political music as music first and foremost, and also try to understand the political in music, if at all, several questions come up. What is political music? How do we understand any existing corpus of old or traditional music in being an expression of society and historical development? How should the classical music tradition be assessed in this context? How can modern, or say Western, forms of music be used to represent politics in a country like ours? Should the music of ordinary people be spontaneous and faithfully represented for their inherent politics, or should music be consciously crafted out of whatever forms are considered appropriate? Is politics about lyrics or form? How can the physical content of the music, that is the nature of the sounds produced, the voice of pitch, the use of voice, pitch, harmony, orchestration, instruments, and so on, be understood? I had the opportunity, due to the richness of the Ipta tradition, to engage with a lot of these questions, particularly with reference to that repertoire, but also in comparison to similar kinds of repertoires which emerged in different parts of the world in the first half of the 20th century. So I had occasion to look closely at these questions about the classical, tradition, folk, authenticity, and several other categories that we use to judge the various kinds of music that we encounter. Let me quote the example of two people, classical musicians of note, who were involved with producing political music as part of the Ipta, Ravi Shankar and Jyotirindra Moitra, who were both part of the Ipta's central squad in Bombay for the period 1943 to 45-46 or so, and then Jyotirindra Moitra also subsequently. In the process of the cultural construction of the independent Indian nation, combining their classically based compositions with political lyrics and aligning consciously with the political movement became important for them. Both of them produced protest music that was strongly based in the Indian classical tradition. They composed songs which often were based on ragas and contained complex phrases and needed to be rendered by large trained choruses that could negotiate the taans and murkis easily. For them, rigor and complexity in composition, orchestration, and rendering drawn from the classical tradition, was a fundamental aspect of music making, irrespective of the purpose. They took the position that music intended for a political cause, for the politics itself to be effective, should not compromise on complexity and rigor in its effort to be accessible to large numbers of people. The accessibility to large numbers of people needed to be ensured, according to such a view, not by a forced simplicity of form, but by depicting political situations through the music and democratizing performance practices and venues of all music, including that which is inspired by the classical tradition. So one of the things that the IPTA did in many parts of the country was to actually make classical music or classically based forms accessible to ordinary people who might not have access to the haloed kinds of performance spaces previously. Now, this was also true about Rabindra Sangeet, for example. One of the things that the IPTA musicians in Calcutta did very, very consciously was to, in some sense, challenge the citadel of Rabindra Sangeet and make it more accessible. In more recent decades, notably since the late 1980s, with communal politics and tensions at their apogee, particularly in the aftermath of the demolition of the Babri Masjid, a number of musicians and other artists began to undertake an inquiry into what kinds of music would be able to address the questions that the political situation in the country had thrown up. At the heart of the communal situation were issues of tradition, heritage, nationalism, religion, tolerance, and citizenship. Musicians began studying and performing repertoires that were excavated from the past, often from centuries before. Examples that come to mind are Shubha Mudgal, Dhruv Sangari, Madan Gopal Singh, those involved in the Kabir project, to name a few among many who have excavated and worked through various repertoires with a critical view, and also many others who have revived traditional but relatively obscure repertoires from the past. The new repertoires that have been created and the forms that have been worked with, reproduced and interpreted, according to me, demonstrate three objectives. First, against the background of a strident majoritarianism, as well as a defensive retreat and reaction of minority communities, the music gives a call for transcending the narrowness that competitive communalism invariably induces. Second, it brings into politics a fresh view of history and tradition going back several centuries. As part of this, questions of nation and tradition have been reinterrogated using musical and literary material from history. Third, the excavation and reconfiguration of traditional forms brings out the cross-fertilizations of different influences in what came to be reified as India's immutable classical tradition. It also seeks to expose the artificial divide between classical and folk traditions by stressing continuities between them. What becomes fascinating, T.M. Krishna's lecture in this series referred to some of this. Further, unlike perhaps with European classical music, the actual distance, as I said, if looked at in aesthetic terms, between the classical traditions and various folk forms is not as large as it is made out to be, and in many cases, the continuity from folk to classical is palpable and discernible in obvious ways. It is the openness to this historical and cultural fact that allows us to stay rooted within our own traditions and its demands for rigor and fidelity, while also taking in impulses from outside its domain. Coming back to the musical route that I started with, why is this history of connections that might be revealed through music important? I believe that we need a non-essentialist understanding of music as borrowed, elaborated, transformed, revolutionized, and passed on within and across boundaries. In actual practice, even if a canon becomes fixed, deviation is abhorred, and a masterful repetition of it becomes the marker of good music. There are any number of examples of musicians and composers who are bearers of an aesthetic acuity which is open to the world of formed and transformed sound. It is this openness outside prevalent boundaries that Kumar Gandharv perhaps personified and put into practice, and maybe, to quote Lorca again, made the hermetic flowers of semitones open in a thousand petals. Thank you.
Friends, after listening to this very well argued case and to erudite rigor, that deep comprehensibility, I think some of you might have some questions. So, is the time for you to ask? The question need be brief. One person may ask only one. And the first one has to be a bit daring, and the rest will follow. So, who is the first one to shoot the question? Raise the hand and speak.
This is a classic piece. And Sheila Bhatia was very well known for using the heel in her theatre productions also later on. Now, according to Madan Gopal Singh, there are about more than 60 variants of the heel which are found in Punjab. And so, you know, it changes a little bit with territory. Now, this kind of heel, or this kind of tune, you hear all over West Asia. What is referred to as arabesque, Arabic style music, is heard all over West Asia. The voicings are a little different, so that's one of the things that I'm interested in. So what happens to voice when the melody is similar, but is voice reflecting something else, a specific context? In Greece, Turkey, Cyprus, again, these are three countries which have a lot of this kind of music. In fact, we hear far more of the Bhairavi Bhairav kind of tunes in the Mediterranean than one hears in our part of the world. And you can actually trace it almost like a route. If you go into North Africa, beginning from Egypt onwards, Tunisia, Morocco, again a lot of these, the tunes are heard. The similarity with flamenco is absolutely striking. Again, some kinds of flamenco. So if you listen to the melodies are very, very similar. So now what is it that connects? We know that there were very large migrations that took place. Now what has happened, and if one looks at musicological work, or the historical work, there is something called the Andalusian music tradition. Now, the Andalusian music tradition is something that is said to have emerged from the 19th century to the 14th, from the 9th century to the 14th century, and is something that reflects the influences of the migration between southern Europe, southern Spain, North Africa, and parts of Persia and Baghdad. Now, interestingly, despite the fact that the Andalusian music tradition, and particularly the flamenco within it, must have been influenced by the movement of the Romas, which is said to have happened from India, the Andalusianists or the flamencologists haven't really started looking at the connections towards India. I'm certain that there are communities in Gujarat, for example, which do talk about old stories and myths which could be connected with some of these histories. So now the question is it something universal? Is it that human beings somehow sing about loss in these scales, or is it reflecting long-term histories. So the differences, to answer your question, the differences are in terms of the voicings, the differences are in terms of the instrumentation, because especially with flamenco, the way the guitar is playing with flamenco actually is not really following the melody. So the cante hondo that Lorca is talking about very often is just a sung form. And there is a recording which is available on YouTube which has Lorca playing the piano and a singer called Argentinita singing the deep song. And if you listen to that, it will sound like the lyric.
Hi, my name is Anurag. Part of this band and non-profit called Manzulistics, and I might divert the topic, but going to the SSR, I just got to know about the event, and luckily, I did most of the things I did not know. I've been hearing from many people, especially Madan Bhai. He's been sharing a lot of these knowledges. My question is, like, we talk about a lot about music and all that, and our, even our National Curriculum Framework has talked a lot about music education. So what part of our work is we go in government schools and low-income schools and we want to be the enablers of music education. So just wanted to know about the history, like where we lack in our education of delivering the music. And so like I studied in a government school where we are taught classical only. And when it comes to perform, it is Indian folk, most of the time it's Indian folk. Just wanted to understand where the break happened. And because there was such amazing music that I learned in my school days, so we had to go to the sanctuary in Khan Market called Manzar to learn music and learn more about it and actually understand it. As you say, like the topic is politically, that's where the understanding happened for us. Just wanted to understand the gap where it happened. And you can skip if you want.
There is a lot of historical work actually which traces how the so-called distance really between, I don't even want to call it folk, I'm not sure about the category of folk itself, but what is considered the superior classical tradition, about how it came into being both in the Carnatic as well as the Hindustani traditions, and how it's a relatively modern kind of construct. Whereas it was far more open and far more diverse. I mean, there are experts here who have worked on all of this. So there is a lot of historical work which has actually shown that in some sense it's an artificial divide. And particularly in a country like India, the divide probably never actually existed.
Yes.
Thank you for your lecture. I just wanted to ask you, for example, there's been a big revival in singing the poetry of Faiz or Habib Jalib in Pakistan, let's say in the last 5-7 years, maybe 10 years, in recent memory. Or for example, Tiam Krishna has been singing Peruman Murugan's newly composed repertoire of poems as explicitly political poetry and poetry of protest and dissent and so on. So, I'm not even sure this is a very good question because it may not have an answer. But you know, as somebody who works on musical form, to what extent do you locate the politics in the lyric as opposed to in the music itself? and you know, you spoke, I mean, the kind of traveling form you spoke about and the spread of it all across Asia and Europe, I think you were talking a little more about conveying emotions like loss and pain and nostalgia perhaps to some extent, or yearning and so on. But that's slightly different than talking about politics or the political, right? So if for a moment we bracket the actual substantive semantic content of the lyric, of the poetry that is being sung and what that means, then what is it about the music that carries that poetry, which we may or may not identify as political in itself, or somehow intrinsic to the music? Is there, I mean, have you, is that something that you find or that you discuss? I hope that made a little sense.
Well, I'll try to answer your question. You know, it's precisely those kinds of questions that I'm addressing in terms of you know, the different variations of the political that I've tried to present. As far as Faiz Ahmed Faiz is concerned, I mean, when he wrote Hum Dekhenge, there was not a word of politics there in terms of what is considered political vocabulary. In fact, if there was something that it was Islamic imagery, but then it immediately conveyed a very, very strident politics to people who heard it. Now, singing about loss, for example. Now, why is it that something, when people are singing about loss and using a particular kind of a tune, a particular kind of a melody, which actually involves a certain combination of notes, it's as technical as that, can cause somebody to, I mean, you know, this big debate between whether Greece is European or Oriental to be reflected through that melody. So it's not as if those melodies were necessarily political in terms of lyrics always. There were groups, yes, that actually sang songs which in those melodies, which were also political at that time. In the, you know, you had the rembetika coming up in Greece as a form which was from the migrants of who came from Asia Minor and who were talking about their travails, and it was something that, you know, they wanted to ban immediately, and the rembetika contained those kinds of melodies. So but despite that, the very fact that cultures somehow seem to identify with certain kinds of melodies, and lyrics also, which might be telling a historical story. So the Heer Ranjha story, for example, it's not just the form of the Heer, but also what the Heer Ranjha story means culturally. That becomes important when somebody composes a Heer. So it's very, very complex. So there are examples where you can say that, yes, this lyric is political, and it has been written as political. But then, in many cases, the lyric is not necessarily political in the way in which one would understand obvious politics. So it's a combination. Historically, one sees, you know, combinations of all these kinds of things. I can give you one example. There is this singer, flamenco singer called La Caeta in Spain, who sings this song about the blackbird. Now, this is a song which, again, sounds very close to the Heer. She sings about the blackbird, and she's talking about the life of the gypsies or the Roma in Spain, and how historically they've been persecuted and chased out of wherever they were. And she's referring to the blackbird. Now, the blackbird is a reference to somebody called Ziria, who was an African slave and a musician in Baghdad in the 9th century, and who migrated from Baghdad. He was chased away from Baghdad, or he left Baghdad because of a disagreement with his master, a very well-known musicologist called Ibrahim Mausili. And
he perhaps became too good for him, or according to the story, he migrated from Baghdad and went to somewhere in Tunisia, what is modern Tunisia, and joined the court there as the court musician. And he was then chased out of there as well, because he sang the music of a rebel poet, a black poet at that point, a slave poet, called Antara bin Haddad. And then he finally went to Cordoba, and he is supposed to have been one of the originators of the Andalusian music school. And he's also supposed to have been the person who carried the Persian lute to Spain, added a string, changed the mode of plucking the lute, and then that's what eventually became the Spanish guitar, or that's what the story says. Now, he was known as the Blackbird. You know, so there are references to the Blackbird in La Caeta's music when she's talking about persecution. So there are very direct kinds of references to these historical connections, which are there, and the lyrics then therefore, you know, use all those different kinds of images, and they do become political when the time comes.
I'm going to tell you something which I wildly speculate without any particular basis. This is the Amritsar session of the Congress. Mahatma Gandhi had already become Mahatma, and three classical musicians have been invited to open the session. And they are Bhaskar Bua Bakhle, Jagannath Bua Purohit, and Krishrao Shankar Pandit. They are all ready, and they've been told that each one of them has to sing for 15 minutes. The Mahatma enters the pandal at the right time, but people are so busy touching his feet that by the time he reaches the dais, the time of the musicians has to be cut by half an hour. So they were asked to all the three to sing for 15 minutes. And they did that. That made me think that Congress at that time was the most radical forum of political protest against the colonial empire. And it thought it fit to have three classical musicians come and perform. Then I started exploring whether there are any bandishes in the praise of the British. As you know, in Hindustani classical music, there are bandishes in praise of very small nawabs and kings and such like. And to my delight, I found that there is not a single bandish which exists in the Hindustani classical music repertoire which sings in the praise of the British. Now, I thought this may apply to the Carnatic music as well. But sadly, in Carnatic music, there are bandishes in praise of the British. So from this, I tried to build a totally untested thesis that we have not read music as such as resistance, as political resistance. You made this point that it need not always have the political lyric, a lyric which is intended to be political. But in this case, there was absolutely no question of any lyric being political. And yet, music itself in its, by the fact of being there and by not acknowledging, in fact, in some ways, the Hindustani classical music and the Carnatic music have bypassed the colonial. They did not admit the impact of the colonial. If it at all, whatever impact it did take, it was in terms of technology, in voice culture, this, that, and the other. The music itself remained. So I would like to read the classical music also as resistance. But that's it. Thank you very much. This was a brilliant lecture. And before you depart, let me tell you what we are going to do in the month of November. It just starts only. We have Shando Khurana in conversation with Naman Ahuja on 13th November in Art Matters in IIC. We have a lecture by Professor Ganesh Devi in our series in IIC again called Gandhi Matters, and the theme is Truth from the Beginning to the Mahatma. This will be at 6:30 on 20th. On 27th, we have Hinducharan Mahapatra Memorial Lecture by Leela Venkatraman, the men for the movement. So you are all cordially invited. If you have time, please find time. Don't waste time elsewhere. Come to these events. They are both illuminating, exciting, provocative. And I'm quite sure that if you come, you'll find nothing more important is happening in the city than what we are doing. Thank you.